My name is Trey Wheeler. I'm 31 years old. I'm the owner of Treyway Music Studios. I'm a producer. I'm a drummer. I'm a teacher. And I'm from Monroe, Louisiana. All right, family dynamic. Wow. I grew up in a two-parent home. My mom and dad were very much so present. I grew up actually on the east side of Barlow Street for most of my life, especially early years. I have a younger brother that was in the house with me. My parents, for the most part, my mom was super, super strict. My dad was the more so laid back one. He let us get away with almost anything until you made him extremely mad, and then you didn't want to see that side of him. We went to church every week. It seemed like every day, actually. We grew up in church. But for the most part, Barlow Street, the east side of town, that whole community was a great spot. It was a great community. Mostly everybody was really close, tight-knit family. I had a family that stayed on the same street as us, next-door neighbors, matter of fact, and across the street. That was the dynamic of my family growing up. As a child, did I like school? Yes and no. I was a nerd growing up. Again, my mom was super strict when it came to grades. If you didn't make, for me, because the rules were different for me and my brother, if I didn't make all A's, like 99s and 100s, she wouldn't let me play sports. And sports during that time was like the biggest thing to me. So I liked school, but she put in me that, oh yeah, you can't make anything less than 97 in my house. And that standard kind of was like a little bit of nerve wracking, because I would cry if I got my report card and we was coming back home to school, because I knew I was going to show her like a 97A, which is kind of crazy if you think about it, because that's still really good. But it just put a lot of pressure on me, to be completely honest, because at that time I thought 97 wasn't success. I thought 98 wasn't success. In my mind, if you didn't get a 98 or 100 by my mom's standards at the time, I wasn't doing well. So I liked it, but it was a lot of pressure for, you know, an 8, 9, 10, 11-year-old at the time. Man, as a child, I can honestly say I thought I was going to be the best basketball player in the world. I would say about 11 years old, I was this height. I was already 6'1". So everybody in the neighborhood thought I was the best ball player. Everybody used to come over to our house and play ball all day after school, especially on the weekends. So, and I started playing AAU, and I was really, really good at the time. So in my mind, coming out of the environment I came out of, sports was the way. Well, actually, the transition from elementary to middle school was quite a big transition for me. I went from Lincoln Elementary, where the principal was Roy Neal Shelling, but the population as far as students was like 100% black. I don't remember ever having like a white person going to my elementary school. And then we transitioned, and we're still staying on Barlow Street at the time during my seventh grade year, going from the sixth grade year to my seventh grade year. My mom decides to send me to Wachita Junior High because she felt like it was more opportunities, it was more diverse. So imagine going from completely black school to still staying in your same neighborhood, but having to change your mindset because you're going to an interracial school where it was, you can say 50-50, 50 white, 50 black. Even the courses were harder, because at Lincoln, I was literally one of the smartest people at the school. I took gifted classes. But when I went to seventh grade and went to Wachita, I was taking gifted classes, and I started off not doing too well because I lacked knowledge in some stuff that was core to the parish schools prior. So it was a big transition. It was tough. It was hard. I had to make all new friends because nobody at that school was from my neighborhood. I had to make a whole nother name for myself, even in sports, because the people in elementary knew I could play ball. But going to this school where the coaches didn't know you, you didn't play like AAU ball with these guys, or you didn't play like Pee Wee League with these guys football, nobody knew me. So I had to start all over again. And even just being around another ethnic group, it just was tough because I wasn't used to that. Again, being on Barlow Street, you don't see any white people come even near you unless it's the police. Once I got into it, got settled, got me a couple of friends, and then sports started rolling in, and I was pretty good in football, basketball, and track. Everything kind of got better for me. I ended up getting like class favorites, most likely to succeed. I was pretty popular. I actually was in choir, and then we fast forward to high school. It was still the same thing. Doing well in sports, had a lot of friends, was slightly popular, but that's when I started getting better and more, I guess, recognized on the music scene. And then I started having to skip or miss a lot of school because I would do these late shows, with these gospel shows with the group I was playing for at the time. We'd get back super late on Sunday, and then, you know, like 4 or 5 in the morning. Then that Monday morning, I wouldn't feel like going to school. So at that point, I just started missing school. But the thing about me is I can hear something and actually see it one time in reference to class and schoolwork, and I can retain it. Not saying that I held on for it for a long time, but I held on for to it long enough to pass whatever test that was. So I still, you know, maintained 3.7, 3.8. Actually graduated with a 3.8, I believe. I never made it to prom because I had started working so much. I've never been to a homecoming dance, all that stuff. I actually almost missed my graduation because for the graduation practice, I was actually in Dartmouth, New Hampshire, playing for their choir spring concert. My flight got delayed on the way back to Monroe. I was flying in DFW, I believe. Got delayed, and I actually almost missed my whole graduation. So that was crazy, you know. But at that time, I was like full blown, like, I can do this. I'm pretty good with this music thing. So I'm going to pursue this at all costs. But I didn't think it was going to be at the cost of me walking across the stage after all those years of trying to maintain good grades for myself and my family. You know, at that rate, I just was like, God, dog, I'm really not about to graduate or not about to walk across the stage. But fortunately, the flight I got came back in enough time. I made it to graduation rehearsal, and I walked across the stage. Why no college? That's actually a great question. I honestly feel like it was meant to happen that way, and it did happen that way. I signed up for the ACT literally 3 times, and all 3 times something happened where I couldn't make it to take the ACT. I graduated in May. In June, I went overseas to actually play, she called it at the time, a trip of a lifetime for Oprah. And I'm 18 years old at the time. So I stay over there. We went to a lot of different countries. I saw the actual world. Like, I saw so much stuff. And again, being from Monroe, I having a passport, going outside of Monroe, going outside of Louisiana, outside of the South, was almost unheard of, especially being at 18, especially going for music, you know what I mean? So that experience, being over there and seeing how an actual band works, how you're supposed to be treated as a musician, how you're supposed to be compensated as a musician, getting outside of the whole church lane and doing something different for the first time. It was mind blowing, and it actually like changed my whole perspective of life or where I wanted or expected life to go. So when I came back from the Oprah thing, to be completely honest, again, I was 18 years old. My head was like this big, and I don't think it was just necessarily for me. I think everybody else was more proud of me than I was myself. Yes, the opportunity was great. There aren't too many people I know that has played for Oprah, met Oprah, have Harpo Studio invoices and check stubs. So it was really cool, but I think the community at that time supported me like so much so that I was like, yeah, I don't college. Fast forward, I come back. I'm like, yeah, college, I'll get to it whenever I can. I'll take the ACT whenever I can. And literally right after that, I played on a few albums. I did a couple of tours. And with each album, with each tour, with each live recording, I just like, oh my God, I actually can do this. So growing up, I didn't see that. You know, like, I knew guys that played on Sundays, or you played in the music on Saturday, but you played somebody at church for a couple of dollars on Sunday. So I never thought, oh, this is gonna be a full-time thing. I can support myself, because I didn't have a family at the time. I can support myself full time with this. But once I started getting out more, getting outside of the city, meeting guys that had done this or they were at the level that I aspired to be at, it really changed my mind. It opened up my mind to where that this, I guess, even a possibility of this being like a full time thing or doing music full time in any capacity. The moment I actually realized I wanted to do this professionally. Funny story, I worked at a mental health facility after a couple of years of being on the road and all that. I needed some stability. I needed some insurance. I needed you know, hey, I know I'm gonna get this check every 2 weeks, because even in the music industry, you can be hot this month, and then next month you're sitting at home not doing anything, trying to figure out how you're gonna pay bills. And by this time I'm 21, maybe 22, and I had just had a daughter, and I had to figure out how to get consistent income. So I do the whole. I work at this mental health facility. I was like a office manager, which ended up me practically kind of running the whole place. And it's weird how it happened, because I was the only person, first of all, I was the youngest person at that office. I was the only person without a degree. But I ended up training everyone. I ended up, my boss started coming to work less because he trusted me with his business. I ended up doing the team meetings on Fridays, implementing different stuff. So that I guess started to show me, hey, you can run a team, you can delegate, you can own your own business. But I worked there for a few years, got a few raises. But I remember talking to one of my old friends every day on the phone. I said, man, I hate this place. And it wasn't a place. It wasn't a job. I had my own office. I didn't have to talk to people. Every day I can close my door and put my iPod in, put my headphones on and just do my work. But I knew that wasn't where I was supposed to be. I knew I wasn't supposed to be working. It just was a gut feeling. I wasn't supposed to be working for someone else. I wasn't supposed to be sitting there from 8 to 5 every day, and I'm thinking about music. I'm thinking about, hey, where can I go next? What can I do next to further my career? But also the other side of it is, man, you got a couple month old daughter. You gotta provide. You gotta have a plan. So I did that for maybe 3 years. And I remember when I first did my first project, which was actually a cover for a friend, Jeremy Davidson. And I don't even know why he even asked me to do this, because I had never produced anything. I had never recorded. Matter of fact, I was so terrible at recording, I put him in the closet, because that's what I saw on Hustle and Flow. They had a closet. They had a microphone. So I thought that was the thing to do. And it came out terrible. But that small seed that he planted was the beginning of a whole lot of stuff that came. So after that happened, I fell in love with production. Like, I literally fell in love with it. Took my laptop to work every day. I would finish my work early, and on my lunch break, I started messing with his song. You Brought the Sunshine was actually the song, that the cover that he did. I'll never forget. And after a while, I had one client that came blindly, because they actually, still to this day don't know why they asked me to produce anything. Did I think a single, maybe an EP for them, still not knowing what was really going on. I didn't know how to price. I didn't know anything. I didn't know about royalties or anything at the time. I was just out here just doing it. After that, I remember sitting in this exact spot, and I told my partner at the time, I said, I'm about to resign from my job. No plan, no money, no... nothing. Like, I didn't even have like a savings account with, you know, something to get me over for the next few months. Like, I had nothing. I literally looked him in his eyes and I said, I'm about to resign from my job. And then at that point, literally right then, I Googled a resignation letter. I copied and pasted it. I edited it, put my name in it, of course, you know, switched some words around. And I emailed it to my boss at the time. And to this day, he and I are still very close. But he told me, I was waiting on you to do that. You're so much bigger than this office. You're so much bigger than this job. I wish you nothing but the best. If you need anything, let me know. And he has been supporting me ever since. And it was a faith move. Again, I had a whole child, you know what I mean, that needed diapers and formula and all that expensive stuff. But I literally can't tell you what it was, but I was sitting in the same exact spot, and I said, I'm finna resign. How do I juggle having a family and running businesses? I guess the one word that pops up first is sacrifice. The second phrase that pops up is, I'm still learning. I'm such a workaholic, like, to my core, that even like 2, 3, 4 in the morning when I do make it home, I'm still working on something. Or if I don't have my laptop in front of me, if I don't have headphones on, mentally I'm still working. You know, So it's still taking time. 3 kids later, I'm still trying to figure out, hey, or tell myself, hey, say no to this, you know, take the kids to Chuck E. Cheese, which I never neglect them. But when you are self-employed, and anybody else that's self-employed can agree with me, you always feel like you gotta get it. You gotta get it. You gotta get it. You gotta get it, because you don't know most of the time if it's gonna be there for you to get the next time. So if it's a record there, I'll do it. More students, I'll do it. If it's a show, and I want to do it, I'll do it. But I'm still learning, you know. And my kids are older. I have a newborn, but my two older kids are in school. So during the day, I try to get some work done. But they're active. They have their own schedules with sports and karate and this and that, extracurricular stuff, even at school, clubs that they're a part of at school. And I'm the supportive present dad. So I want to be at the practices. I'm going to be at the all the beta club stuff and all the conferences with the teachers. I'm going to be there. And the older they get and the more involved they get, it's just figuring out how to maneuver. It's figuring out what's most important. And 10 times out of 10, it's going to be my family. Advice for a younger Trey: keep pushing, keep fighting, be resilient. Because it's so easy to be the hottest thing around in a city like this, where the ocean is not big, the pool of people to pull from is not big. So it's easy to be the best here. But I would tell them, continue to grow, continue to better yourself, because it's so much more outside of this the area. So much more outside of the 318. So many other opportunities, so many people that are way better at what you do than you are. So we can never get content. Keep being, wanting to be the best, keep pushing to be the best. And just stay consistent, stay resilient. Advice for just a business owner in general: I would say listen to your heart, listen to your mind. Don't listen to the fear of the older or younger people, your family included, because I think we make a lot of decisions off of what appeases our family. I think we make a whole lot of decisions on, I wonder what if they okay with this. I wonder if this gonna make mama happy. I wonder if this gonna make dad happy. Or if this is a safe route. Like, you can have fear and be a business owner, especially in a city like this. So find whatever it is that you absolutely love. Figure out if it's a demand for it. Research it. If the school route is the route, go to school. If not, that's totally fine. Figure out what the demand for it is and go for it. But you have to be consistent. You cannot let your foot off the gas. You cannot allow fear to overtake you, because if so, that business is not gonna fly very long. Even more importantly, like, I just don't allow other people's fear, even the people with my same last name and bloodline. I've never allowed that to shake me, because it's easy to say, boy, you can't do that in Monroe. You can't make no money. You need to go over there to Chase. You need to go over there to CenturyLink, or go to one of these plants so you can provide for your family. That's not my path. No knock to anybody that work at those places, because they do well. And I pray you continue to prosper. But the thing is, that's not for everybody. That's not the end all be all of Monroe. Like, that's not the only thing that you can do here to succeed or be successful. So be fearless. Don't listen to the outside noise, even if that outside noise is somebody that birthed you or raised you, because it can be that close to you. Wow, I actually had no knowledge of that. But what does it take, with all that against us, what does it take to be successful in this city, Monroe? I just say resilience, being fearless, knowing what you want, and being extremely focused, because it's so easy to get caught up in everything else that's around you. It's so easy to get caught up in the violence. It's so easy to get caught up in the drugs. Like, it's literally easy, because that stuff is simple to obtain. I think most importantly, just being focused on whatever the goal is. Like, you got to see that and see that only. You know what I mean? Like, that's crazy that you even say we're top in violence in the country. Monroe, I would have never thought in a million years that we'll be noticed for something so negative. But I think if you stay focused, set your goal, stay focused on that goal, and move towards that and that only, I know you could be successful here, because it's worked for me and a few others that I know personally. That fear, that noise is on the outside of us, that violence, all the stuff that's right next door to us, right in front of our face, you can't see that stuff. You literally got to keep your mind and your focus on the goal and move towards that, and you'll be just fine. I'm sure of it. Opening up here instead of going anywhere else, I think being here gives a sense of hope. It's a sense of pride for me, because I feel like most of the more successful people, they get what they need here, and the first opportunity they get, they leave because of, I don't know if it's lack of support, the hate, the shade, the whatever, but I absolutely love this place. And I just want to inspire people and show them that it don't matter what your background is, it don't matter what neighborhood you grew up in, no matter if it was a one-parent home, two-parent home, or no parents at all. I know some people that practically raised themselves because they lost their parents. Whatever the situation is, it's not too bad or so bad that you can't come out of it and be successful. And what is success? What is it to you? Is it a couple thousand dollars in the bank? Is it affecting people's lives? Is it actually being an influencer here? You know, is it when somebody speak your name in a conversation you're not around, they don't have anything but great things to say about you? Is that success? Like, you got to figure out what's success to you. And once you figure that out, and once you you don't allow yourself to be shaken by, that's a small city. That's such, man, I don't care nothing about that. It's Monroe. I love this place. I want to be a pillar of hope. I want to be the poster boy for, he was the first person to do this full time, even playing drums, even producing, even having a school for drums. It's unheard of here, because nobody succeeds in Monroe. That's what they say. We all kill each other. We all drugged out, or we all we don't get past high school here. That's not true. That's a lie. And I'm a living witness of that, and so are a whole lot of others, that you can thrive, you can be successful, you can make money in this small market. It's here. You just got to tap into it and roll your sleeves up and get after it and be consistent. But that's why here. That's why Monroe. I absolutely love this place. I adore this place, even with the nastiness, even with all the stuff that they say that we do or goes on here, all the statistics, all the negative statistics, it doesn't scare me, because I feel like under all of that darkness, there's still light, and there's a few lights around here, and I just choose to be one for a place that's I guess we overshadow by darkness. I choose to be the light in Monroe.
All right, that's a wrap.